Paramolecule should have a chirality center. Chirality center should have four different solutions. The center exists, but the molecule is not chiral, and that those kind of molecule are middle compound. Usually, those chirality center is multiple, a single one. Which molecule can you separate physically? Enantiomer, racemic mixture, this is the same meaning, right? Enantiomer mixture is a racemic mixture. So those, except without the special treatment, it's difficult to isolate. And conformation isomer at room temperature, they convert very quickly to each other, like a quasi form or anti form of protein. So it's practically almost impossible. Epimer is kind of enantiomer, correct? No. Epimer is a kind of diastereomer. It's a diastereomer, that's why it's physically different. That's why you can isolate them for the purified. Epimer has how many different points is a different? Only one point of the chirality center. That's epimer. If you add racemic amine, you add R amine, S amine, and you generate RR, SS, RS, SR. So each pair is an enantiomer, but the other pairs are diastereomers. You make mixtures of four. So this makes the situation more complicated. To isolate this, you need to have single chiral amine. Then, let's say this is an S, then you have a RS, RR. Then you have two S's, and by adding one chiral amine, it has a maybe or maybe not. It may interact with one of them better, and then they can have maybe possibility to make better crystal, and they can be crystallized out from the mixture. The others may remain in the solution, then you can isolate this. It does not guarantee, but you introduce this and you increase the chance physically separate those. Okay? Racemic plus racemic make more complicated situation. It doesn't help. And prochiral, you have RS. If you add prochiral material, it doesn't change. Still, those are still racemic mixture. Chirality center is only one, RS is there. So, no chiral, pro chiral doesn't help. You need to have one single chiral. Okay. Okay, so this is a quick summary. Now we're going to chapter 6. So today we started about organic reactions. First time, this is organic reactions. When you break to me, something is changing. So far, we have seen the structure, naming, property, and the things. Now we start changing with the molecules. And type of organic reactions. If you look at here, in this case, you have a double bond, and this one is added to this molecule. Right? So if you classify those types, this reaction we can call this is an addition reaction. This two is an added to this addition. If it's opposite, you have this, and then you remove this, and then it's kind of a reverse reaction or addition reaction. So that kind of reaction we call as elimination. Elimination is a removal. Okay? Removal reaction, elimination reaction. So addition reaction, elimination reaction, seems like there are the total bond character, the molecules. I did it prior to our reason. Easy, right? Addition or elimination. Or the next step, next type of reaction is you have this, and then this one replace this, and water is added here. To water, this hydrogen is replaced by this methyl group. So it's a similar situation. And in this case, something is exchanged or replaced or substituted. So this type of reaction we call substitution reaction. So this is the chemical term we are going to use from now on. Addition, elimination, substitution. Meaning is exchange. Okay? Exchange or replace. So three types. One more. Same molecule. So far we have two molecules. Somehow they interacted. Added, eliminated, exchanged. One molecule, but there are internal changes. In this case, this part is reduced, this part is oxidized, and then this proton is transferred from here to here. So this kind of a rearrangement, JBR, experiment the type is a rearrangement, the type of the reactions. So four types, type-wise, addition, elimination, exchange, rearrangement. So let's see the notation of the chemical reactions. Chemistry is science of molecule. Which part of molecule? Chemistry handles electrons, electrons movement. Okay. So electron movement, if you have a half head, one electron is moving. Right? Two head, two electrons is moving. That's the map we use. Okay? Now, if you see here, one electron is moving one side, the other electron moving the other side. And if it goes this way, now one bond is defined by two electrons. There is a single bond here, another bond here. So for breaking, there is a two possibilities. One possibility is one electron each share. Then radical, radical, right? Or two electrons moving either this way or this way. So if two electrons move, then it moved to one side, then accepted one becomes a negatively charged, lost one becomes positively charged. Two possibilities. Not difficult. That means these radicals, they are neutral, electrically neutral. So this is dissociation. And this reaction can be reversible too. If there are two radicals, they can meet together, make a bond. If there is plus and minus, charge is important, but to make a bond, you need to have electrons. If it is just a charge, sodium plus and chloride minus, they can interact with each other. But there is no covalent bonding. Those are ionic bond. It's kind of just electric attractions. So that's not what we call as a covalent bonding in organic chemistry. for making covalent bonding, you need to have a sharing electrons in between. Sharing is covalence. Okay? So to the left, one side either contribute to one each, or one side should provide two electrons. Again here, in this case, look at this head. It's a double head. Okay, that means two electrons moving. And then plus minus becomes neutral. So in physics, in material science, mass should be conserved, right? Charge should be conserved too. So not all. So neutral, neutral, neutral. Plus minus neutral. Okay? So before and after the reaction, everything should be conserved. Atom should be conserved. Charge should be conserved too. Okay? Now, using this. So first type of reactions. Radical reaction. You can assume radical reaction, maybe radicalism of single electron. So if there's a radical is already formed, usually radical unstable, because one electron is high energy state. That's why they wanted to meet with another, the lone pair electron, to make lone pair, sorry, one electron wanted to have the another electron and meet together, make pair. Pair is more stable than radicals. If there is one radical and neutral molecule, then there's a possibility is this donate one electron and this donate one electron here and make a new bond. And then the other side is it donate one electron here and then the other one moves to here. So radical generate radical. So this reaction is a pi-wise addition, elimination, substitution, rearrangement. What is the reaction type? Out of the four types. This is a substitution because in terms of this guy, A had originally had a pattern B, but now A has a pattern with a radical part. It's a substitution reactions. So radical type also can happen. Now, if this radical meets with double bond, so previously this was a single bond here, so single bond is broken, and then new product formed. And then this group is removed. If it meets with a double bond, and the electron source is not from the sigma bond, this is from pi bond, which is weaker. So this pi electron can be donated here. And then radical meet here. The other side, this one electron moved to the other side. This becomes radical, but they were not separated. Extra pi electron is involved in this reaction. Reaction type? Addition reaction. Okay. It's similar to double bond and two motif added together. So this is a single one, but anyway, it is an added addition reaction. So this is a typical reaction of radical reactions. Now we have methane, boring hydrocarbons, no functional groups. And chlorine, CO2. And if you mix this together, and you need to give high energy here, like very high temperature, several hundred degrees, or giving very sharp energies, like light. Light has a photon. Photon has very condensed energy in there. So that kind of energy provided, and then reaction happens. This reaction, just looks like a simple reaction. It's like a exchange reaction here. It happened. Substitution reaction happened. But if you look at those, actually there is several steps that are hidden behind it here. Most of them are quite boring molecules. So if you give more and more energy to them, they start to vibrate more and more vigorously. And then at one point, the weakest bond is broken. That breaking happens like this. So chlorine-chlorine bond is much weaker than carbon-carbon bond. And chlorine-2-chlorine is broken into half. So this is a homolytic cleavage broken in the middle. So it generates radical. Radical is unstable. Unstable means more reactive. Radical meets, so this reaction is initiating the making the radical. So radical reactions usually, in the beginning, you need to initiate the reaction by generating radical. Making radical is the first step. How? Using light, temperature, or catalyst, kind of a strong energy given there. And once you have radical, now the next step is, even though this molecule is quite stable, radical is very unstable. So it can take one electron, and it can generate this radical. This radical can react further with another chlorine, and then generate chlorine radical. This is like a recycling again. This radical also can react with this guy too. But if this react with this, then take one hydrogen here, then result is the same. Starting with this and react with this, then this hydrogen is shifted here, then it forms methane, and this one is a methyl radical. It's the same result. So end result is not changing. So that's why effective reaction is transferring this radical to methane, to chlorine, to methane, to chlorine. This is kind of a propagation moving forward. So this type of the continuing reaction is called as a propagation step, sometimes step, or a chain reaction. It's a kinetic recycling over and over. Okay. After those chain reaction is almost used up those materials, and there's no free molecules left over, then there are all radicals. Then those radicals, now they meet together, and then remove those radicals. Chlorine, they meet together to form this back. The chlorine is one, and then make a product. Or methyl, they meet and then make the ethane. Maybe this is a minor product. Majority product, maybe this one is a majority product. And this step we call termination steps. So if you summarize after this, radical reactions, initiating radical formation. And then that radical is reactive, you know, attack everywhere. And regenerating those radicals by this propagation or chain reaction. And then after it's all used up, then they remove those reactive radicals at the end, combination reactions. Seems like this reaction is, if you have the bond here, this is bond. Okay. In the beginning, you gave energy, and to break up the bond into radical, almost looks like this kind of a tool and clean in between here. You can imagine that this reaction can be quite harsh and difficult to control. It can attack everywhere. Even CH bond can be broken by radicals. So this reaction, time to time, this is useful in industrial scale. If it's tons of molecules you need to make, then sometimes we use radical reactions. But in laboratory scale, this reaction is not very much favored, because this reaction is difficult to control. Then how can you do? Maybe better way is that you don't want to cleave in between. You want to cleave this side or this side. That method may be more milder and also easier to control. So that's why we have learned radical is one type of reaction. Industrially important, but most of the reactions we are going to learn from now on, those reactions are polar reactions. Polar means the charge is shifted to one side. Okay? So far, the radical reaction we have seen, hydrocarbons, carbon-carbon or carbon-hydrogen, or chlorine-chlorine, because everything is equivalent. And there's not much shifted to one side, but carbon is attached to heteroatoms. Now we can see delta minus, this one is shifting. Usually if you see this kind of a picture, more electron rich part is usually red color. More electron positive side is usually blue color. Of course it's arbitrary, sometimes it can be changing, but most of the cases this is more common. Now by looking at this, you can see, okay, this is more electron here, red color. which is shifted into this way. This shift of electron is determined by which effect? How do you judge whether electron shift is this side or not this side? Which parameter do you use? Electronegativity. Okay. What is the unit of electronegativity? Dipole moment is one measurement. After this is defined, and then you can calculate the dipole moment. But that's a result, the parameter. But electronegativity is a causing. 원인이 되는 거. So electronegativity doesn't have any dimension. It's just a relative scale. So similar terms, you may be confused by ionization energy or electron affinity. Those two are, unit is, dimension is energy. Okay, those are different. Electronegativity is a no dimension scale. Okay, by this electronegativity, now we have seen carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, halogen, those electronegativity increases. So then, most of those, the functional groups, they are more electronegative than carbons. Means, always this side is delta positive and this side is delta negative. How can you make opposite? Carbon delta minus. Electropositive one, what is electropositive? Metals. By connecting the metals to this, now you can reverse this and you can make carbon electro negative, means carbon is more electro rich. This is electron poor. So by using this combination, now we can make the bond polar covalent bond. Okay? So that's why functional group is interesting and more useful, because they generate this kind of shift of the bonding, make the bond into polar state. So using this polar, comparing to this polar state, carbon-carbon, single bond or double bond, this molecule is not polar, it's symmetric. So in this case, it's difficult to induce polar reactions attacking here. So polar case, if you have this kind of heteroatom, now this one can be, you know, more negative here, more positive here. So nitrogen, oxygen, halogen, all electronegative side. And this side, metallic side, including boron. Boron is a kind of a weak metallic too. Those are more electropositive. Hydrogen, carbon, which one is more electronegative? Carbon is slightly more electronegative, 2.5. Hydrogen is 2.1. That means carbon and hydrogen, electron is not in the middle, it's a little shifted to the carbon side. Okay. So using that as concept, now we can, you know, look at this table. But looks like many, but not really complicated. Everything here is, they are electronegative atoms. And then metal is the only case, electropositive here. All other heteroatoms, they are more electronegative. Now, here is electronegative, the alcohol, alcohol oxygen. Here, if you add acid, okay, into alcohol, now you add acid. And what happens? In the beginning, we have learned about the role of acid base and compared that with the oxidation reduction. I said that's very important and very fundamental. And biggest difference between them is acid base, they do not provide electron permanently, right? Just a 주는 척, 받는 척. If you add acid here, now protonation happens here, partially, temporarily, it take out this lone electron here. If you look at those map, electron density map, originally this alcohol, this side was a delta positive. By adding proton here, this electron is further shifted this direction, and then this side becomes comparing today is much more positive. Originally, this was partially positive, but they have electron-rich side here. But proton is donated here, acid attached here, that attracts this extra electron and attract more electron to this side. So this side becomes more blue color than here, right? So this side becomes more positive. So that means this has same delta positive, delta minus, but actually now it becomes much stronger delta positive. And there's another positive on top there too, right? By adding other proton. By this disturbing, the acid can destabilize the molecules by attracting extra electrons and make this molecule more reactive. Okay? And later, this can be removed, then it can go back to the original state. That's why acid itself is not changing. That's why acid is called as a catalyst. It didn't participate in the reaction, but that disturbed this molecule, stable molecule, into unstable state, making this side super positive and make it more reactive. Okay, so that kind of reaction is what we call polar reaction. And polar reaction, how do they happen? If you have a positive one, negative one, of course they may attract to each other by electric the attraction. So then, there is electron-rich one, electron-poor one. Electron-rich one we call nucleophile. Electron-poor one we call electrophile. Phile means like. Okay? Philosophy is film. So electrophile like electron because it is electron deficient. It's a poor electron-poor. That's why I want more electron. That's electrophile. Nucleophile is the opposite. So this side is a nucleophile. This is a nucleophile, has electron rich. That's why it can donate this electron to carbon side. So carbon is a nucleus in organic chemistry. Okay? Electrophile, electron poor. Nucleophile, electron rich. Then electrophile, nucleophile is more similar to base or acid. Nucleophile is more similar to base or acid. It should be base, right? Base has electron rich. Okay. Later we are going to compare what's the difference between base and the nucleophile. But for now, let's just say it's similar. And oxidant and reductant, which one is more electron rich? Oxidant, reductant, which one is more electron rich? Reductant. Reducing means by giving electron. Difference, giving electron permanently, that's reductant. Giving the electron temporarily, that's a base. Giving electron and make a bond, that's the nucleophile. Okay, that's what we are going to look at here. So by looking at this map, we can define then this red color side, these are all nucleophile side, electron rich, similar to base. Blue color side, electron poor side, those are all electrophiles. In chemistry, we see those electrons movement. Electrons are charged, and simply speaking, the more electron rich one may prefer to react with electron poor one. Those pairing, nucleophile will react with the electrophile. Okay? Breaking, new bonding, both of them is a polar reaction. That's what the basic nature of the polar reactions. Now, BF3, can you guess this is an electrophile or nucleophile? I look at the color. What do you see? Blue color, electron poor, electrophile. B doesn't have no electron, right? It's exceptional, the element from octet rule. it doesn't have 8 electrons, it can have 6 electrons. That doesn't mean that it's heavy enough. It doesn't have a lone character, this is electron 4. So BF3 is also electrolyte because it's electron 4. Now by looking at this, then this is this pi bond react with this HBr. If you look at this HBr, H side is electropositive and this side is electronegative. So even though you don't look at this map, still you can see, okay, this is delta minus, delta plus. Right? Then, if this pi electron attacks, this is the extra electron here, if that attacks, it may not attack this side, it may attack this side. It may attack this side, because this is electron rich, and this is electron poor. So then, from now on, by looking at those reagents, you start to see, imagine, where is the electron density is high and low. And usually it's easier to draw those arrows from which side to pole side. There's more matching with our the concept of movement of electron. Then this is electron a little rich, and this can move the electron to this side. So reaction may start from this side, not this side. Then if you compare with the sigma bond and pi bond, sigma bond, usually carbon-carbon bond or carbon-hydrogen bond, they are very tightly bound. So usually they are very boring, too stable. That's kind of the situation of regular reactions. If you don't break in between, then usually they do not participate in the reactions. In comparison, pi bond is relatively more mobile, right? More flexible. That's why this pi bond can act as like a lone pair electron or extra electrons. That's why it has a slightly red color. Means those electrons have a chance to donate. Means the pi bond can act as nucleophile. Make sense? This kind of electron extra electron they have. So those electrons can be donated. So that's why pi bond among double bonds itself is symmetric. So it's a surface symmetry, but that pi electron is kind of an extra electron that's act as electron rich species, act as a nucleophile. Okay. So using that, if they meet together with the HBr, double bond is a nucleophile, and then it donates the electron to whom? Bromine? No, it provides that electron to hydrogen. Hydrogen is at first, and then bromide can be removed. And then this bromide, it forms the product of this one, and then bromide can react with Br minus, and this is C plus. They can make this one now act as a nucleophile attack here by making this Br. We will see this step by step. So if similar reactions happen here, double bond here and then meet with the HBr, what can be the product? Now we have a double bond here. Double bond has an extra electron. This extra electron can donate to proton first. And then Br minus is removed. And then Br minus come back and attack back here. And the product is reaction type wise, what type of reaction is this? This is an addition reaction. Right? Addition, elimination, substitution, this is an addition reaction. Reaction mechanism wise, this happens this way, not through the radical reaction. This time, we use this one as polar reactions. Which was a nucleophile? Double bond was a nucleophile. Okay. I draw the product directly here, maybe intermediate. This is intermediate. This is another intermediate. And then this attacks here. And then we finish the reaction. Okay. If if I draw the reaction like this, similar reaction, now product is this one, similar type of HDR addition reaction. If I draw the product like this, can you tell what was the intermediate? Can you draw? This one looks straightforward, but if you draw this one, another possibility was you could form like this. 주미가 그린 거는 이렇게 되네. There was two options. So proton, this electron, this pi electron could be donated here. Then this donated this way, then it can form this as intermediate. Or this donated this way, then this one could be positively charged, right? Then product could be different too. One product can be that one. If this is intermediate, then your product would be this one would be your product. Right? So this kind of details we are going to learn after meditative example. Today we are just to see very brief introduction. Similar situation here. We draw the product like this way, but there is a possibility that this can be cis or trans kind of situations. Okay? Those kind of details we will learn step by step. But today is a very basic idea of electron, which one attacks electron four. Nucleophile attack electrophile. Nucleophile acts on lone pair electrons or pi electron or negatively charged lone pair electron here. This can act as a nucleophile, electron rich species. Electrophile, electron poor species, like this, carbocation, or is shifted to this way, C halogen, then is a delta plus, or this kind of proton, or CO double bond, still this is a delta plus. This kind of electron poor side becomes electrophile. Okay? So that makes sense. Electron rich reacts with electron poor. So several little more details about the types. Sometimes the nucleophile can be negatively charged. If this is negatively charged, attack here, and then end the product, one negative altogether, product should have one negative too. One minus should end up with a one minus. Attack here, then take it up, and this becomes neutral. Then this electron was shifted to this side, becomes negative here. Electron was moved there. Okay. Or nucleophile can be neutral, like the fiber. Extra electron, but at neutral state. And it attack here and push this out. Then originally both of them are neutral. Product is positive and negative. Still, somehow, it's a gel. Okay. Electrophile, so nucleophile can be either negative or neutral. Electrophile, either positive or neutral. Electrophile cannot be negative, right? Neutrophile cannot be positive. Make sense? Neutrophile is electron rich. So either negative or neutral. Electrophile can be positive or neutral. So let's look at here. So here, positive, it can be electrophile. Then this attack here, and this becomes positive, and this becomes neutral. Or, electrophile can be neutral. Then neutral attack neutral. Then it becomes positive. So anyway, electron rich one can be either negative or neutral. Electron poor one, either adjective or neuter. Now, another important thing here is, once you move this electron to donate something, it cannot stop here. Because once you stop, donation stop here, then the octet rule is broken. Once new electron pair is coming in and attached here, just attached here, then this hydrogen has too many electrons. Two here, and then two new electrons coming here, so four electrons. That's why the flow of electron cannot stop at one step. It can, once this is donated, and this bond should be given up. Push, and then the other side should be pushed again, and it finished those reactions. To make those octet rule is satisfied before and after. Okay? 금방 익숙해질 거야. Once the reaction is attacked, if it's negative attacked positive, then that's fine. Negative meet with the positive, both of them are neutral, then you can stop there. But other cases, once this is attacked one side, then this side, once it gets a new electron pair, then the other side, you need to give up another side of electrons to keep those octet rule. Okay? With that, now we can draw those reaction, so-called reaction mechanisms. In organic chemistry especially, what is the reaction mechanism? That means how those electrons are moved. That's the question. Which electron attacked where, and where the new bond is formed? That's the electron mechanism. That's the reaction mechanism. So if you look at here, this reaction, can you draw those arrows? Looks like this is nucleophile, electron rich. And here, and something happened here. Can you draw those arrows? Nucleophile here, then you need to have electrophile as a partner. Electrophile in this case, this is withdrawing. So this is delta positive and this is a delta negative. Then, most likely this may attack here and push this out. That's the result here. Okay. This electron-rich part attack this column, and then it does not stop here. It pushes this out further. And ended up as one negative here, ended up then negative here. Electron was moved from here to here. Type of reaction-wise, this reaction is?
Addition.
This is addition. This is the pushed one. If it's addition, then this should be one molecule. This is a substitution. Pushed this, and then something is replaced. This is a substitution reaction. Exchange reaction. Okay. Now, so we just have seen very basic the idea of polar chemical reactions. Electron rich one, donate electron to poor one, and make a new bond. Okay. During those reactions, now we need to think about equilibrium and reaction speed. If this reaction happens, type of reaction was the addition reaction we have seen. By looking at this, we can write down those equilibrium constant. Equilibrium constant is usually drawn like this. Put those reactants on the bottom, and then product on the top, and those relative ratio is equilibrium constant. Okay. Equilibrium constant value is equal. So this value is quite high. That means this equilibrium you shift to which direction? Right side or left side?
Right.
It's the right side. This is much bigger. So whether this reaction, if this is a reversible reaction, it can go right side or left side, then how do we define whether which side is more preferable? So that it can be defined by this so-called Gibbs free energy. Almost every reaction, in principle, all the reactions are reversible. Now, which side is more preferred? Usually we draw practically only one side of the reactions, but most of the reactions are in both sides, we should assume. So, if equilibrium is more preferred to the product, Gibbs free energy should be decreased. Gibbs, Gibbs is a person's name. Free energy means that's more available energy. Available energy should be used. That's the direction of the spontaneous reaction goals. Free energy is a good energy, high quality energy. That energy should be used to move to that direction. This is what is the role of this? That's the conservation law, thermodynamic first law, thermodynamic second law. Gibbs free energy should be used for reaction direction. It can be said as also the direction of entropy should be increased. Okay, they have the same meaning. So Gibbs free energy should be becomes negative, then the reaction goes. And then formula wise, we have seen this formula before. And then by looking at this equilibrium constant, this is a positive, this is a negative, then negative, negative, positive. So this becomes equilibrium constant, becomes more than one. Okay. That moves the two product directions. If this is a positive, then this is less than one, that means goes reverse reactions. Okay. Now, we can calculate this kind of parameters, Gibbs free energy and enthalpy and entropy. And Gibbs free energy, the general term is like this, as you have learned in general chemistry. Delta G is defined by delta H minus P delta S. S is entropy. So in this case, by looking at this, to make the reaction preferred to the product side, it's better to have a delta H minus. Correct? How about delta S? Delta S should be plus or minus?
Plus.
Should be plus. This reaction, by looking at this, molecular number, originally two molecules, becomes one molecule. It's reduced, right? It's more numbers of molecules are generated, entropy increased. More random. Right? So this is entropy decreasing reaction. So that means entropy reaction-wise, this reaction is not preferred to this way. Entropy-wise, it's preferred this way. Enthalpy-wise, it's preferred this way. Altogether, enthalpy value is bigger in terms of the delta H is bigger than P delta S, and the reaction goes to this way. So this reaction, if I ask you, what is it driven? This is an enthalpy-driven reaction. Enthalpy took the more important role to push this reaction to this way. Entropy's role was relatively small. That's why this reaction goes to this way. Two factors always compete to each other. Okay. So this is equilibrium and thermodynamic other aspect. And the term we can read. Now, to judge for the delta H, delta H is the enthalpy. That determines both the stability of the product and reactant. And how do you measure that? That measurement we can get from bond dissociation energy. Bond dissociation energy, I have asked you several times. If there is any bond, that energy is breaking in the middle to generate two radicals. This energy is a bond dissociation energy. And this reaction is a this reaction happened in radical reaction, not polar reaction. So by looking at this table, we can judge those which bond is more stable. Now previously we have seen these values in kilocalorie per mole. Kilocalorie per mole, carbon-carbon bond was approximately 100 kilocalorie per mole. Actually 80, 90, but anyway, the overall approximately 100 kilocalorie per mole. Now, in your textbook, it seems like they put this number in kilojoule per mole. So 1 kilocalorie is 4.2 kilojoule, about 4 times. So carbon-carbon bond is approximately 400. Okay. Previously, we have seen radical reaction. We have seen chlorine-chlorine. That bond dissociation energy is almost a half of carbon-carbon. That's why you have a chlorine Cl2 and hydrocarbon, if you start to heat it up, and this will break up first, because that part is half stable, then carbon carbon bond. That was radical reactions. But after that, we have seen, let's look at here, water. Water molecules, oxygen, hydrogen, bond dissociation energy, what do you feel? They said this is even stronger than carbon carbon bond. Does it make sense? Water, oxygen, hydrogen, that dissociation, is that so difficult? By looking at this number, carbon-carbon bond is about 400. This is almost 500. In our feeling, in water molecules, oxygen, hydrogen, it's not very difficult to dissociate, right? This number tells that that is dissociating with OH dot and plus H dot, breaking in the middle. As I showed you, there was the Jamul said, you break in the middle. That's so difficult. But usually what we are seeing is this bond is not breaking homolytically. We see this bond is breaking this way. And this becomes OH minus plus H plus. Heterolytically, it's breaking. This is the meaning of polar reactions. Polar reaction is much more abundantly happens. They may compete, but heterolytical cleavage doesn't happen much in water conditions. Polar reaction is much more dominant because that's much easier. Okay? So that's why polar reaction is dominating most of the organic chemistry. So in comparison, let's say this is hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide is also a reactive molecule because it can be similar to chlorine, chlorine, even weaker. So hydrogen peroxide you add, then they can be cleaved in between, break this up, and generate OH radical very quickly. So that's why chlorine, hydrogen peroxide, this kind of molecules are usually radical initiators. So those reagents has weak bond in terms of homolytic. Bond dissociation energy is smaller, easy to break. Other than that, if you look at all of the chemicals here, above 400, they are, your chance is polar reactions. Push those two electrons to one side, then break in the middle. So by looking at this, if you compare these reactions with natural reactions, so this reaction, the phosphate is here. Phosphate is cleaved from this molecule, and then you can measure those delta H, minus 9. Minus 9, anyway, is a negative value. Maybe if you add the water, the reaction goes to this way. Prefer to go to the right side. Compared to this, if you have triphosphate, like ATP, ATP, biological battery, reactive materials, energy source, and ATP added, and then this reaction, breaking this ATP to make ADP, if you look at the delta H, minus 30, means which reaction is more preferred to go to the right side? Stronger negative, this is much easier. That's because this one has much more stable, much more unstable bond here. And part of the dissociation energy is much lower. That's why it's easier to break. So to determine which one is more stable, so we can compare those accumulated bond dissociation energies. And then product is more stable than reagent, then reaction goes to this way. Okay. So that's the meaning of the relative stability of the product and reagent. And that can be drawn in an energy diagram. If I draw, so for these reactions, we have seen this reaction several times today. Addition reaction. So this lone electron, this pi electron. Now it acts as a nucleophile. Electron is donated to this proton. It donates here, then pushes this out and to generate this intermediate product. Now I said this one as a proton, not hydrogen. You need to understand that difference. Proton is H plus, hydrogen is H dot. Okay? So this is polar reaction. So this attack only this hydrogen side and remove these electrons. That's why this is now attack proton, now H dot. Now what's this point here? Now we can draw those relative energy status. This is the starting point reaction. And this is CH3, CH2 plus product. Which one is by looking at this? This is the energy scale and this is the reaction progress. By looking at this, which is more stable? Reactant or product? Reactant is more stable because this one goes higher, this is energy is higher. So this is more stable here. This is less stable. So here, now we can see, if you look at those first step of reactions, this one attack here, this reaction may happen together. Then the reaction happens, this pi electron attack this proton, and then Bl is ready to leave. If you look at here, the electron flow, electron is moving from here to push here, and then this one is push here. That would be the status of here, transition state. When the reaction happens, this electron is donating to this, and then this electron is moving to this. At the top side here, this reagent may not be, this species may not be able to be isolated. So you can just imagine. This may attack here and push this out. And then that state is here. That is what we call transition state. Transition state is unstable. We cannot isolate them. We can just imagine them and just model it or calculate it. We cannot isolate them. Now, by looking at the different cases, now here, one thing you need to know here is this activation barrier, activation energy. If this activation energy is very high, to reach to the transition state, you need to give a lot of energies. That means it's more difficult to go. So by looking at this, if this activation energy is small, then reaction is faster. Okay. If activation energy is higher, reaction is slow. And if you compare those relative energy state, so here and here, reactant and product is more stable. In this case also, reactant and product is more stable. If this this difference, delta G zero is the same, then delta G determines K value, correct? Equilibrium constant is defined by delta G there. That's why if delta G zero, this delta G zero, then equilibrium constant is the same in both. Which is more preferred? Product is more preferred. But what's the difference between these two? Reaction speed is different. Reaction speed in chemical terms we call rate. Rate can be also said Joule, but in chemical terms, rate is the term for speed, chemical reaction speed, that's rate. Rate-wise, this is much faster, and this is much slower. And that part is determined by this activation energy. Now, in comparison to this, if you look at here, this reaction, this is going a little upstate. Activation energy is not so high. Reaction is fast, but equilibrium constant is not preferred to go to product. It is more preferred to go to the reagent side. This reaction, speed is also very slow because of this the high activation energy. And equilibrium is also preferred to this way, reactant side. So, two parameters here. One is which one is more stable, then that determines the equilibrium constant. That parameter we call thermodynamic parameter. Thermodynamic parameter you need to compare delta G zero, stability of product and reagent. The other parameter is how fast the reaction happens. That is determined by this activation energy, delta G double level. That parameter we call kinetic parameter. Kinetic parameter determines those rate.
한번 넣을 수 있으니까 나중에 돌아와서 다시 그릴게요.
Okay, by looking this reaction back. So here, this is a 5 electron, donated this electron to proton, and we just have seen after here, but actually this is not finished, the final product. This is intermediate. And then bromide comes back, and then attack here, and this is real final product. Then reaction scheme was not single step, actually there was two steps. First one was attacked, and then forming this intermediate. And second reaction was carbocation meet with bromide, Br minus. They reacted together and it forms this product. Overall reaction. This is more stabilized, right? So this reaction is released the energy, released the heat of the energy. This reaction we call exothermic reaction. If it goes to the opposite way, released one exothermic, if it's going into the more stable one, it's absorbed energy, endothermic reaction. Exothermic is going to the product side. Endothermic is going to more reactant side. It's more reactive species formed. Exothermic and endothermic. Okay. Now in this reaction, overall, starting from here, the finished reaction here, is this the endothermic or exothermic? It's an exothermic. Heat was released to the outside, exo is outside. This is an exothermic reaction. Reaction speed is defined by? Which one? Delta G1 or delta G2? This is more important because this is higher than this one. Once it reaches and come here, then this reaction is very quick, very fast. So this reaction at the speed we don't see. This is a rate determining step. Once it's overcome here, then that defines those reaction speed. Reaction speed, kinetic parameter, how fast the reaction can happen. Thermodynamic parameter is defined by this, the delta G zero. Thermodynamic one we call delta G and zero. This is the state. State of reactant and state of a product. Transition state related to one, we put this one, double level. That's why transition state we call, or always put it, this double decker is just the transition state. And this one is an intermediate state. What do you see? Reactant, product, intermediate, two transition state. Okay? So this is how we describe the reaction in terms of energy diagram. Two energies, state energy, and activation energy. 나중에 다시 복습. Okay, these reactions, sometimes this can be two-step reactions, so sometimes it's the single-step reactions. So if this is a single-step reaction like this, if you add catalyst, like an acid or base, the product state and also the reactant state, the state is not changing. That means equilibrium constant is not changing. 일어날 일은 언젠가는 일어난다. 속도만 다를 뿐이지. If you add a catalyst, now this reaction profile, the pathway is changing. So then, starting and ending point of energy state is not changing. Thermodynamic parameter is not changing. But kinetic parameter wasn't changing because activation energy was changing. So this is the role of a catalyst. Catalyst, biological catalyst and chemical catalyst. Biological catalyst case, let's say here, using ATP, if you transfer phosphate to this oxygen, usually those biological catalysts is huge enzymes. Huge enzymes bind to this molecule and then properly orient these molecules and ATP transfer from one side to the other. So very difficult to reaction here. They push those reactions into proper position and then transfer this phosphate to the reagent And then it can control those reactions by changing those reaction pathways. So that's usual case. And also the cofactors is also quite big because this is reaction site, but enzyme needs to recognize this part too, and then hold this and then transfer this hydride to the product. So usually in biological reactions, the catalyst is huge for the enzymes. Cofactor is also huge. The temperature should be maintained. We don't want to have 100 degree in somewhere for the reaction, right? Always near to the 37 degree. So that's why they need to have this kind of a specialized high energy work size of catalyst. In chemical reactions, in comparison, usually we can control temperature maybe quite low or quite high, several hundred degree. And catalyst also, we don't want to use a too complicated one. Usually we use acid or base or metals. So this is kind of the difference between chemical reaction and biological reaction. Yeah, 다음 시간에 리뷰 한번 하려고 오늘 한 거를 한 시간 만에 여기까지 왔네요. 자, 다음 주에 so we will have a midterm exam next Tuesday, right time here. Okay? Tuesday, not Thursday. And we will have a midterm exam now. We have 1 hour. Thursday, we have a review what we have done so far. And that's why I would recommend to have the assignment until Tuesday, not next Tuesday, until Thursday, not next Tuesday. 조금 서둘러서 이번 주 숙제는 미리 해. 그래야 리뷰할 때 조금 더 도움이 되겠지. 그리고 if you want, why don't you have 예상 문제 for midterm exam? If I like it, then I may put it up and you will get extra credit. But this one, it's fair to share with your friends. So this 예상 문제, you send me by Saturday 9 p.m. Then at least I can put it up onto the PLMS and other fans can see all the problems on Sunday. Right? Okay. 공부하다가 지금까지 경민이라는 노트를 잘 만들어줘서 여러분들한테 제공하고 있고, 문제를 각자 푸는 친구들은 각자 푼 것들도 있기는 한데, 공부하다가 이런 문제가 시험에 나올 것만 같아요. 하고 정리를 해서 올려주면 내가 좋아하면 시험 문제 날 가능성이 높겠지. 그 문제를 12시까지 보내주면 친구들한테 같이 볼 수 있게 내가 그걸 정리를 올려줄 테니까 일렬로 확인해두고 그런 문제는 풀어보면 좋겠지. 오케이? 필수사항은 아니고 옵션들이야. 오케이? 그럼 오늘 수업은 여기까지 하고